Good afternoon. First of all, I'd like to express my gratitude to the organizers of today's event, to my fellow presenters, to you all for coming out here today, and to the people who support this wonderfully beautiful space. Thank you for inviting me. My name is Laura Poyetin, and today I'll be talking about making a living and making a life. Although some people say this quote has been misattributed, I left it as Winston Churchill. You make a living by what you get, but you make a life by what you give. I was born in a relatively small suburban town on Long Island called Islip, and I lived there until I was 15 years old. And at that time, I decided that I had quite enough of public high school, and I wanted to go and become a Rotary exchange student. So I applied for the program and was accepted. And I was to be going to a place called Hyderabad, India. So I set about learning Hindi and buying long skirts and long blouses and preparing myself for a year living in India. A week before I boarded the plane, the president of the local Rotary Club called me and he said, "Laura, guess what?" And I said, "What?" My friends had already gone back to school. He said, "Actually, your host father in India has disappeared. And you can't go to India. But I can send you to the Philippines, Thailand, or Brazil." So I thought about it for a minute and I said, "How about Brazil?" 10 days later, with my long skirts and my long glasses, I arrived in Sao Paulo, Brazil, which is quite different from Islip, Long Island, New York. I fell in love. A beleza do Brasil. Brazil is an incredibly beautiful, charming, colorful, musical, magical, inspiring, passionate place. I couldn't believe it. Everyone was so nice. My friend later said, "That's because you don't know what they're saying." It was true, it wore off a little bit over time. But I was quite struck with the beauty of the place. And simultaneously, I was also struck by the ugliness of what I saw around me. Now, I wasn't a particularly sheltered young woman, but I also was pretty shocked by what I saw in this major metropolitan city. The smell, the poverty, the constant feeling of volatility in the air when you walk down the streets and wander just a little bit off my usual path. It was scary. So in my mind, I lived in a world of contradictions. I lived with a very wealthy, loving, wonderfully fun, generous family in a house that looked very much like the one on the left. And every day, I and they walked by houses that looked very much like the houses you see on the right. And it was confusing. I became quite good friends with the woman who was a housekeeper in this beautiful home. Her name was Nita. She was the one who taught me how to speak Portuguese. And she was just a wonderfully kind, funny person. She thought it was hilarious that I didn't know how to speak Portuguese well. She thought my clothes were really weird. But she loved me, and she was nice to me. One day, my host father came to me and he said, "Laura, I don't know how to tell you this, but you can't really be friends with Nita." Now, he was a very wonderful, generous guy, I could tell that this was a difficult conversation. I trusted him. I knew he had my very best intentions in mind. He had the very best intentions for me. And so I heard him out. And he said, among lots of other things, "It's just not the way it is here. It's just not like what you think it is." And when I wasn't completely convinced, he added, knowing me very well, he added at the end, "It might make Mita's life harder." And of course that was the clincher. Mita and I were still secretly friends, but I didn't go about the household or my daily life treating her in quite the same way I did prior to that. Out of respect for the culture and for her life. So those of you who've lived in places like Brazil are probably very familiar with this kind of contradiction of things that happen. And Brazil, although you might think that people sort of share a vision of things like soccer, it's actually the case that very wealthy people and very poor people root for very different soccer teams. So this is not a place in which the divide is bridged. It's also true on the beaches. You think of any typical Brazilian scenario, there are beaches that wealthy people attend, and there are beaches that poor people attend. But the one place I found where everybody could get together and be friends and have a great time was on the dance floor. And samba certainly has a very strong history of bringing to light political and social and economic issues that the entire population struggles with, but that go pretty well unnoticed in other aspects of daily life in Brazil. Don't need to play it. No, it's okay. I'll play it again. So this left me with a very big question in my mind. Despite not wanting to, my visa expired and I needed to return home to Iceland, Long Island, and go back to Iceland Public High School and finish out my senior year. And so I did. And although I desperately wanted to go back to Brazil, I went on to college instead. Not too far from the Berkshires. And I studied cultural anthropology. And I think as I look back and I was thinking about today's event, I made that choice because I wanted to reconcile these differences. I've always been the kind of person who wants to know what's right and what's wrong. What's the right thing to do? What's the wrong thing to do? And sometimes you can trust your gut, but sometimes you're just not sure. And at that time, the predominant view of cultural anthropology was something called cultural relativism. Cultural relativism is a concept that refers to the fact that what is regarded as true, valued, or expected in one social system may not be so in another. It is important for several reasons, the most important being that if we are more aware of cultural relativism, we tend to be less blind and arrogant in relation to other societies and less rigid in evaluating the idea of changing our own. So this stuck with me for many years as a kind of viewpoint for how to live my life. But I found there was something missing. I immediately went back to Brazil, and although I had sworn as a cultural anthropology major that the last thing I would ever do would be to teach English. That was the most colonialist thing I could imagine doing in my entire life. But I really wanted to go back to Brazil. So I did. And it didn't take long to figure out that that although I was a Smith grad, the only relevant skill I could offer in Sao Paulo was teaching English. So I worked during the day with children, ran the loom at Iazaji, which was a language school for middle-class Brazilians who wanted to improve their English for professional reasons. And then I taught business people as well in my free time. And that was really making a living. But I wanted to make a life. So in the evenings, I was a teacher's assistant in an adult literacy classroom in Sao Paulo. Most of the people in the room were quite similar to my old friend Nita. And there was something about this particular experience that really struck me. One day I was sitting with a woman and I was literally guiding her hand along the page as she wrote her name for the very first time. And I thought, wow, she is so excited. Just for a minute, think about how many times a day you write your name. You sign a credit card slip, you sign a check, you sign a birthday card. It's really something that we don't even think about at all. But not being able to do it, not having access to that world that literacy provides, creates a huge wound that never heals until people learn how to do it. It's very painful, but it's also very inspiring to be part of that process. Again, my visa expired. Those visas, they just expire. I have to go home. I came home and I decided that I should join my college friends in making a living here in Boston. So I got a job working at Harvard University, and then I got hired working at a venture capital firm. I went in one day to the venture capital guys I worked with, and I said, I really need to quit here and go find a job. I was just a 10. And they said, well, we'll give you a job, Laura. We really like you. And I said, you're giving me a job? I thought I was going to get out of this. And they said, no, we'd like you to join us in starting a software company. So I did that. I helped them start a software company. But I was always desperate for this feeling of giving back. So at night, pretty much every night, I taught ESL at a local language school in Boston with Brazilians. And we had some samba parties along the way, which was a lot of fun. But again, I was really left with this question. I couldn't put my words together. I was making a living, and then on the side, I was making a life. And I really wanted to find some way to work it out. And that's when I began a very sort of rigorous practice of meditation. I particularly like this quote, your work is to discover your work, and then with all your heart, to give yourself to it. I was very inspired by a lot of what I learned, both in the formal Buddhist meditation practice, but also just along the way of meeting other practitioners. And I went on to get a graduate degree in teaching English as a second language, the one thing I swore I would never do. And I taught at a variety of different places in public school systems and academic institutions and at small nonprofits. Today, it is my great privilege to be the executive director of the Literacy Network of South Berkshire. And over time, I've learned more and more about literacy rates and how they impact people. So in that classroom, helping a woman write her name, I knew it on a gut visceral level. But I think it's quite staggering when you look at some of the literacy rates in our country. So things like, for example, 14% of Americans read at or below the fifth grade level. 29% only read at the eighth grade level. And among those with the lowest literacy rates, 43% live in poverty. For those of you who understand economics, a 1% increase in average literacy rates yields a 1.5% permanent increase in the GDP. 75% of state prison inmates did not complete high school or can be classified as low literate. And 59% of federal prison inmates. Low literacy adds an estimated $230 billion to the country's annual healthcare costs. So imagine not being able to read your prescription, not being able to read warning signs, not being able to look up symptoms and know how to self-diagnose. The effects of low literacy cost the U.S. more than $225 billion each year in non-productivity in the workforce and loss of tax revenue due to unemployment. Overall, more than half of countries with data have youth literacy rates of 95% or higher, which is wonderful. So I invite you to find your samba, the place in you that brings all the contradictions, the passions, the challenges of your life, and find a way to give back, be it in film or food or farming or planning. To me, it's been a great gift to find this particular path. Of course, to do a little LitNet promo. But these are just a few local organizations that I know are very open to accepting new volunteers to help with a variety of different types of services to provide. And so with that, find your samba, and I'll play you one. That's okay.
Yeah, so well.
You were doing that. So it's the very last slide. This is a refresher. Thank you very much.